Hey, so new year, I'm gonna keep trying some new things. The winter 2018 season is underway, and so far I've seen a lot of good, but I'm gonna save those thoughts for my seasonal impressions video. Luckily for you, there's also some stuff I've seen that I haven't enjoyed as much. Nothing really awful though, and as a result, there really isn't anything that I think deserves its own video. At least yet. Looking at you, Deathmarch. So what I thought I'd do is compile a bunch of little things, nitpicks, if you will, into one video. So let's see how this goes. So since I mentioned it, Deathmarch seems like a good place to start. Though as I mentioned before, I don't have a ton to say. I'm enjoying it more than Isekai Smartphone, but that's for a number of reasons. That said, there was this one instance at the end of the first episode that just kind of left me confused. So we're basically at the end of the episode, right? And the main character's watching a bunch of random nobodies fight a dragon. And then we see this girl, who by design seems more significant, get whipped up into the air and she starts to fall. Looks kinda bad for her, right? Well, all of a sudden, an ally of hers casts a resist fall spell and she starts to descend more slowly. Fine, cool, whatever. But then, for some reason, our main character, who mind you, just saw all this happen, decides to leap up and catch her out of the air like he's some kind of hero, when it didn't seem like she was really in any immediate danger? I don't know, it was weird and felt out of place. The rest of the show seems fine so far. It's too soon to tell if they're really gonna do anything new or interesting, but we'll see. Moving right along. Seven Deadly Sins is finally back for its second season. Hell yeah, it's back and they're introducing power levels? Really? Why? What? Just why would you feel the need to add this now? Did you think Hawk wasn't doing enough? And especially when you immediately then mentioned they can fluctuate depending on the circumstance, then why even bring them up in the first place if they're gonna be that arbitrary? Sorry, it just left an immediate meh taste in my mouth, and it feels like some Black Clover would pull. But as much as that irked me, it wasn't what upset me most about this first episode. Power levels? Eh, maybe you can do something creative with them. I'll give them the benefit of the doubt for now. My real nitpick is with the opening, and oh boy is it a nitpick. Because the song is fine. Action and animation? Your standard shonen affair. Overall, I like the OP, but there is one shot at the end here. You see this new character that we haven't seen yet, and yes, commenters, I know who he is, but I'm not gonna spoil it for people. Anyway, we see him coming down with his axe, and you can see his left arm on the right side of the screen, and it's kind of flying out as he's swinging because, you know, momentum. Except, he then seems to counter that momentum because you see the next shot, and he's brought his arm down to kind of grip the axe, but not really at the last second. A little awkward, but okay, okay. Then though, as he gets swept up in the flames, it cuts again, and you can now see his arm is back up over his head, suggesting that as soon as he contacted the ground, his left arm swung up into that position at a speed that would dislocate most shoulders. And even if that was possible, maybe it is because power levels, it's just an awful match on action. We have no clear indication he's even starting to move his arm. If there was, I'd be more inclined to forgive it. But instead, it just looks off, and now you're probably never gonna be able to unsee it either. Don't you just love nitpicks from an editor? My last little nitpicks for this experimental thing are gonna be centered around the Crunchyroll Anime Awards show. Not another award show, because let's be honest, that's a lot bigger than a nitpick. And honestly, with Crunchyroll, I don't have a ton, because it does seem like they are improving the quality of said awards. I think it's really cool that they brought in a lot of judges to decide the nominees, and that 3 out of the 6 for Anime of the Year are shows that are not able to be streamed on Crunchyroll. That being said, I do have some constructive criticism, let's call it. First, on the note of judges, I don't like how the votes are still decided entirely by the community. It's the reason why Yuri on Ice won literally every award it was nominated for last year, and why, if we're being honest, Hiroaka is probably gonna win most, if not all, it's nominated for. Fan voting just doesn't work in my opinion when, like it or not, there is a huge discrepancy in terms of popularity between series. Though I don't want to see the community completely ignored either. I think what could work best is you have the fans decide on the nominations via vote, and then the judges deliberate and ultimately make their final choice. And if you're still worried about popularity being an issue, which you could rightly be, then say have half the nominations be selected by fans, and then the judges get a say in the other half. I think that would be the best way to ensure that shows get the recognition they deserve, even if they weren't the most popular. I think it's a better proposition than just hoping to God your favorite series from the past year wasn't nominated against Hiroaka. And ultimately, it could end up drawing more eyes to that particular series. Just my advice if you want to take steps to making the anime awards feel more legitimate and worth winning. And as far as nitpicks go for the actual nominations this year, Bondrude, really? Sure, he was intimidating and seems like a great villain, I absolutely love his design, but he was on screen for 10 minutes of the last episode. He hasn't even met our two main protagonists yet. I would have personally subbed in Azumi from Shokugeki no Soma Season 3. He's also intimidating, imposing as hell, and looks like he could actually be a white whistle. Oh, and he actually has a measurable impact on the plot. We don't only see him in flashbacks, but whatever, Stain is probably gonna win either way. Other gripes include, I think you really could have chosen a better picture for Deku here, just saying, and Momo definitely deserves a nod for Best Girl. Don't get me wrong, I love Sue, I really do, but Momo had an actual character arc this season. Sue was, well, Sue. Consistent, sure, but when Hiroaka is littered with best girls, like everyone agrees, why not go with the one who showed some real growth? Aside from that, I would have liked to see Princess Principal or Girls Last Tour get more than one nomination each. I think you could include either of them in the conversation for OST of the Year, and Princess Principal maybe for Best Action Series. But those are relatively minor nitpicks in comparison, and it was cool to see them get at least some love. But yeah, those have just been the random thoughts bouncing around my head that I don't think each really deserved their own video. So I thought I'd try this. Speaking of which, what are your thoughts on anything I mentioned? What about the idea for this video in general? Whatever you're thinking, let me know down below. Also, really quickly, yes, the top 2017 characters are still coming. It's just taking a while. I promise it'll be out. Just in case you were wondering. But thank you as always for watching, and an especially big thanks goes out to my awesome patrons, PenguinPandaZero, OverjoyedSoup, MVPino, James Morton, and everybody else for generously supporting me. If you would like to become part of that awesome group, you can click the right to visit my Patreon page, you can also click the left to subscribe, in the middle to watch more of my content, feel free to leave a like if you enjoyed the video, stay awesome, and I'll see you next time.